They tried to paint her as sort of a patron saint. She's holier than Mother Teresa. She's all this sort of rubbish.
She's a friend as well as somebody that you look up to.
One of the most unusual people I've ever met.
I was absolutely flabbergasted by the strength of her mind.
She was conceived with great love.
The whole point of working, I think, of making money is to be able to give it away. That's my buzz. Maybe not be anybody else's buzz, and so be it, but it's my buzz. And that's my gift to myself. And I couldn't live my life without it, and I don't give a toss whether it's, you know, whether it's sexy or not. Oh, I just love it. I love it, I love it, I love it.
Every day, in more than 40 countries around the globe, 1 million people visit a body shop to buy a cosmetic product. The company is an incredible success. The products are all guaranteed to contain natural ingredients, and animal testing is absolutely forbidden. These may be great marketing tools, but that is not their reason for being. The Body Shop is a campaign platform for social change, focusing on human rights, the environment, and third world issues. It's led with vigor and imagination by its founder, Anita Roddick.
See, I think the role of business is public good. You know, if you're given the right to transact a business, have a business transaction, a shop or a business, it has to be for public good. It has to be, it goes beyond the profit that you get. You've got to be concerned about the customers. You've got to be concerned about the people who employ you. That's what traditionally, I think, businesses were about. It just sort of got lost over the centuries.
I think they come into the shop because they like the products. They like the fact that they're made up from natural ingredients. They also like the fact that we spend an awful lot of money into researching the product and not on the fancy packaging side of things. You get a lot of people that are, you know, feel Collins as green people. They feel they're doing something for the environment by coming in here. They can bring their bottles back into the shops and get them filled back up and save money. And they're not creating any more pollution. They feel they're doing their bit. It's like when we have campaigns on in the shop as well, they can take part in them. I think product definitely, but I think because we stand for so many different things as well, they feel it's a good place to come and shop.
The first body shop was set up with a £4,000 bank loan. In 1993, the company expects to turn over almost £150 million. Having grown 40,000-fold, the company still holds firmly to its basic founding principles.
We want to have fun. We don't look upon business as serious. We just see it as a way of life. It's a way to trading. It's just a way of life. And if we don't, I'm one of our great franchisees. He's always saying, oh, you know, if you ain't got a sense of humour, you've got to get out of retail. And that's very much the case here. I mean, if you ain't got a sense of humour, you certainly got to get out of body shop.
I bought her some aloe vera
That one to Mary, please.
Who's Mary?
But the thing that really impressed me is the fact it's run and originated by a woman. Got to say that. I admire that lady very much. I'd swap places with her any time.
405, 406. I don't know what power is. For me, it's moral influence. I'd rather have moral influence over people than power. Power to me is like what the military have, or what politicians have, or what, you know, jailers have. I don't want that. I want to be able to be persuasive so that people can hear what I have to say and make, and if it's reasonable, make a judgment on it. We have problems. More often than not, countries abroad, Japan, Europe, America.
Anita Roddick and her husband Gordon run the company in an unconventional style, alien to mainstream business. They believe that business and social activism can go hand in hand.
I had been so moved
and impressed by what had happened to the Jews during the Holocaust as a kid. I picked up this book and saw and read about the concentration camps. That was seminal for me. That kick-started me into social activism at 10 years old.
In 1976, Anita left the running of a restaurant hotel to set up a small shop in nearby Brighton. The shop was to provide her with a living while Gordon was away riding horseback from Buenos Aires to New York. To their amazement, that little shop turned out to be an immediate success.
When he had four stores, I said, "Grief, how many of these things do you want?" And he said, "Well, we'll just see how far it goes." And I think it was, that's what we're still doing.
In 1984, Body Shop shares were sold for the first time on the London Stock Exchange.
My job then, which was sort of in the franchising side and looking after our property requirements, suddenly the world became job became easier overnight. People knew who the hell we were.
Brighton in 1976 was one of the best places to start an alternative business. The first shop in Kensington Gardens catered to the hippies, artists and liberal intellectuals that loved Anita's homemade shampoos, sold in cheap containers that came in a whole range of sizes.
One, two, three. For me, going shopping gave me more ideas because I used to get mad. I used to go into a greengrocer's shop and you could buy one apple or you can buy 2 kilos of apples. You could never do that with lotions and shampoos. You either had a big bottle you bought, that was it, mostly. So that really, with the question, why not? Why can't you have it? Why can't you have different sizes? Why can't you bring it back for a refill? Why not? Why do you have to pay all this bloody packaging? So that was really a discontentment that set off the style of the Body Shop.
The shop that she had was an absolute ruin, and this is why she painted it so. I mean, painted the walls dark green to hide all the grot. There was dry rot coming down the walls, water and things like this, and she just plastered all this paintwork on it and put up some quite simple shelving and sprayed around some of her scented products, and it really looked fun. I mean, people rather enjoyed it.
People say to me, "But why did you have natural colours?" And I think, why? God, everything looked like liquid diarrhoea. Everything fades. I want colour. I want things to brighten the eye, like the life's a beach and then you fry. You know, it's a gorgeous combination of hot summer colours.
Anita Roddick soon became well known and admired for her commercial success and outspoken style. And despite her disdain for the financial community, she was even chosen as the United Kingdom's Businesswoman of the Year. Dressed in a Bob Dylan t-shirt, with two baby daughters clinging to her sides, she went to see her bank manager looking for a £4,000 loan needed to set up the first shop.
So, he said no. And of course, and I think the most frightening thing that I had was enthusiasm. You know, you don't jump up and down and get incredibly excited in front of a bank manager.
I can see her now in this street with this wild mane of curly black hair and full of enthusiasm and showing you everything and sniffing this and try that and put this on here and so on. She just carried you away. She was great fun.
Good,
I liked her.
Good. Who's the manager here? At the end of the week, I hadn't made my £300. I knocked on doors and sold the products. I just had big baskets and sold them.
God, it's so quiet. What have you done?
Right. How are you doing? Perfect. Nice to see you.
Well, one of the things she did, I remember, that she sprinkled some of the scents around the street just outside the shop, which people were drawn into then. And then she would show the rosemary and other lavender and so on, scents like that to draw them in. And she was always very aware of publicity, but in this rather zany, sort of offbeat way.
Good, right, now what we're going to do is fill it up. You've got Jane, why have they got like this up here and the other shop doesn't have it? Why have they got...
Because it was incorrectly merchandised in the other shop, they didn't have the promos.
This is just, it looks great, right. Now, what I'm wanting to do now is in each of the shops, where they, come and look at you like bloody little come birds. You've got skin colour on your legs.
No,
it's great.
It's good.
She's been on holiday, hasn't she? Just volumize everything.
All the original features I had in the body shop was because we had no money. We had no money for making more than 20 products. So we made 5 sizes. That makes it look a bit more professional. We had no money for fancy packaging, so we used the simplest packaging. We had no money for a square label. They're more expensive, so we did a round label. So the design of the body shop was around the logo. We had refill, not because we were environmentally friendly. We had a refill because we had no bottles. We only had 300 or 400 bottles, so we said, come back for a refill, because we couldn't afford bottles, or bring a bottle back. And all those features stayed with us, and we didn't give them up when we became successful.
But things were very different in the early years. Even though her first shop was an enormous success, the bank refused credit to set up a second. Anita had to turn to a friend, Ian McGlynn, to borrow another £4,000. For a half share in the business in return.
Nobody would give me money. You know, I'd only been trading 6 months. I thought, oh, this'll never work. This is never work. Bottles look pathetic. They're all in these cheap plastic bottles, handwritten labels. It's too crazy an idea. So he loaned me the money. And he knew me for months, years before, and I was an incredibly hard worker. So he knew he'd get his money back. What he didn't know was how wealthy he would become. And I thank him for giving me the money. People often say, my God, this man is now worth £150 million with all the shares he has. Isn't he lucky? Wasn't I lucky that somebody actually said yes to that? People don't see that because we have a society that thinks that more is better, that I should be worth £300 million. That's fantastic, sexy, you see. That's power. It's bullshit. It isn't.
Our growth has come through franchising because they had no money to develop the business themselves and certainly had no intention. I mean, if they had seen this 20 years ago, they would have walked straight away from it. Franchising, for instance, just came because Gordon wasn't even aware of the word. But someone says, this is a wonderful store. I'd love to do one. And his reaction, well, why don't you? I'll supply you the product. You go and do it in wherever you want to do it. Later, that he discovered that there was this word franchising, which was actually described what he'd already naturally set up.
I learned that it's easier for a woman to get a loan from the bank to renew her kitchen or get a new car than it ever is for a woman with kids, or even a woman without kids, for a business. I learned that the system is very, very male-dominated. The lesson of that is that you have to be part of the system. Once it's working for you, you can become your person. And so now they'd love to overload you with money. They'd love to pour money on you. But so all these wonderful ideas that young people have, and we had it easier because we had a hotel and a little restaurant. But what about all these young kids who've got great ideas? And they're never, because they haven't got that collateral, will never be able to put that into practice. What an incredible shame that is. The hotel was really home and income. It was a big house where we rented off the rooms. That was it, quite, in a nutshell. But we seemed to gather the greatest eccentrics in the world. I remember going back one day, and my mother was babysitting with Mr. Wilson, this wonderful man who was living with us. And there was an argument going on in the kitchen. And there was a priest from Holland, and there was my mother, and there was Mr. Wilson, and there was Gordon, all arguing about abortion or arguing about, became like a salon. And I looked at my mother, and this was like a frozen image. She was cutting the eyebrows of Mr. Wilson because they were bushy and she found them objectionable. She had brandy everywhere. The priest was drunk as a skunk. It was all wonderful. But people still write to us about those crazy summers where it was just like, it was like a commune more than anything. Yeah, it was different. We also grew marijuana in the garden. We had this sweet little garden with this poor old gardener who was one had no legs, you know, to come in. And we got this little plant and we said, oh, this is a marijuana, let's see how high it would grow. And he couldn't understand why this 20-foot high weed was being allowed. And I remember my 40th, was it my 40th? No, no, it was, must have been, I can't remember. Maybe it was my 38th birthday party or something. And it was when I was leaving the hotel for this little cottage down the road here. And we had this wonderful party, and Gordon had bought me a bicycle for my birthday, and the wind had got broken the marijuana plant, so we cooked it in some ragu. Oh my God, my mother was never stopped talking, and so we had, everybody was hungry. So we used to do fun things. That was Littlehampton in the 70s, that was.
She's still the same now, isn't she? She doesn't care about money, doesn't worry at all, as long as she can help the need.
The big issue is a stimulating new monthly paper, which makes for the most compelling reading. Unrestrained interviews and articles on the most sensitive social issues. Buy a copy. And every penny of the 50 pence price goes to benefit people less fortunate than you and me. Anita's social principles made her decide to sponsor this paper, inspired by her former teacher's work for the homeless.
If you speak to the tramp, you often find, as I have found in life, that there's more wisdom, there's experience, there's that wisdom that's gained from the hardships and the hard side of life, which is often more true wisdom than what we gain from books. And also there were people, human beings, real people with real stories. And if you just stick tramp on them, you put them in a box and you stick them on a shelf and you feed them at regular hours and that's all. And I wanted them to see that there was more to the people of the road than just a poor man whom you give food to. That there were people who had a life history and had a place in society too.
It gives homeless people a sense of self-respect because they're actually out earning a wage.
Morning, Frank, how are you?
Not so bad, sir.
How many do you like?
30, please. If they want to put some aside, really work at it, save up, they can save up a deposit for somewhere to live, a room or whatever. It's just like a first step. If they've got a room, then they can get a job. I'd like to buy the biggest shoe, help the homeless.
Yeah, why not?
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you. I hope you enjoy it, sir. There's a lot of unhappiness in the world. You see that if you stand selling the papers, you can see so many people are wrapped up in themselves and unhappy. And a lot of people are very funny, the way they react to things. And if you speak to them, they sort of jump back like a scalded cat sometimes. They expect you to be a certain way. You're supposed to be blind drunk the whole time and abusive and rude to them. And when you actually turn around and you're polite, they're not quite sure how to take it. And you can have quite a laugh at people.
But it's amazing how a person's action done intuitively can have such an effect on an onlooker, especially a young child. So her looking after these people that have no place in our society just, you know, affected me immensely. Littlehampton was very, very exciting for a young kid in those days, because it was the real working class seaside town. All the working class from the East End of London would take their 2-hour train drive and land in Littlehampton. The Italians played an immense part in that because they all had cafes and restaurants. And so the very fact that we had a restaurant where all the young kids went to because they had a jukebox and pinball machines, No, I was very excited. I liked it, being a kid here.
Anita's heroes were her mother, Gilda Perella, and her uncle, Henry.
Likewise.
Can't touch anything and just touch it lightly and not be in, you know, in feeling or not get involved in some sort of experiential learning. And the romantic love that I know is often criticised because it has no substance is something I've always lived with because of my mother. Which when, I mean, I'm as a baby at 5, 6, 7 years old, we used to lie in bed. And she never, ever read us stories about Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs or Red Riding Hood. She'd tell us how we're all conceived and what was happening, and the bombs were dropping, and my father was playing, you know, Chopin's Nocturne in E-flat. Well, you, as a child, you wake up and you think, well, you've got to have romantic love in your life.
I went to Italy when I was 19, for a big party there. And Henry happened to be there as well, but I was engaged to Donny in England at the time, you know. And he says to me, would you give up your boyfriend and let me court you instead? I said, I couldn't do that, you know, things like that don't happen in Italy. In Italians, you don't give up one and go with the other one, especially they were cousins.
And I can remember in my little, in the living room of my house, brushing my hair in front of the fire, because it was this wild woolly hair, and in the 60s you wanted it straight and long like a hippie. And I said to him, it's so sad that you and Henry never had children, just fantasizing about what they would be like. And she was in the kitchen, which is like an inch away, and she said, we had. And there was, oh, it was the most exciting 5 minutes that followed. I suddenly thought, I've got stepbrothers and stepsisters somewhere, where are they? And I said, who, where? And she said, it's you and Bruno.
If two people love each other so much, you want a part of that person, don't you? Don't you? Knowing as it's a hopeless situation, he's going to go away, you'll never see him again. And I wanted part of him. I didn't know I was going to leave through the war years or no, I didn't know nothing. I said, all right, you're going to go away, but I still have some part of you. That's what I call a love child.
Made me view my mum in a different way. Suddenly I saw her as romantic, young, making incredibly antisocial decisions in the middle of the war, in the middle of a sort of a repressive Italian family, to make love, bear the children of the man she loved, and have immense duplicity to be able to carry it off for 19 years with only one or two people in the community, her family, knowing. Well, she got my vote. For the rest of my life. She got my vote. I mean, it's immense courage, foolhardy, stupid, but you know, that's the power of love. And I'm never, you know, the power of passionate love, and there is no way I could see anything being better than that in life.
I believed from that day on in the power of intuition, instinct. Of course, I believed that I was his daughter anyway. I used to write poems. My mum's got poems that I used to write to him, and I used to refer to him as my father. And so I felt so comfortable in knowing that I was part of the Perillis, you know, and they lived in circuses, they were romantic, they were the artists and the poets, rather than the Perellas, who were solid tradespeople. Oh, I was so thrilled. But I knew it, you see, as a kid, I knew I was different.
The Body Shop develops all its own products using natural ingredients. At the company's research and development department, scientists still operate in the very same way Anita did from the kitchen of her first shop.
I bought these books on how to make your own cosmetics. I know everything about foodstuffs and cosmetics. You want to have a wrinkle-free area around your eye, you crack open an egg, you open up, you take the white of the egg and you put it around your eye and it tightens up and you don't have wrinkles. I mean, that's how we used to learn how to make the things. But then we found, but then that was just one aspect. The other aspect is living with traditional tribal people as I worked around the world. Or travel around the world, I used to stay with families and used to watch what they do. People put oils on their skin, wash their body with pineapple or with sand. I mean, It's nothing magical. They just used to use ingredients that were natural.
Since her days traveling the hippie trail of the 60s, Anita is still continuously on the move and never around the Littlehampton headquarters for much longer than a few days.
Baudelaire called it La Grande Malade, which is fear of home and hearth. It's a real need to believe that I'm a global citizen. It's what gives me the edge. I get out of my office, I travel, and I bring back ideas.
On her travels, Anita spends much of her time in remote areas of the world. From this, she brings back many of the materials used in the laboratory research and development work.
Formulate and develop most of our products. You guys are dead meat tomorrow. We launched over 50 new products last year. It generated nearly £12 million in the UK market alone. And what's this? Oh no, I don't want this done to me. I'm his foot scrub.
And over here, here's what we've done earlier. Yes, it's Aaron Puri from R&D. Here we go, Jeanette and Pippin. Here we go.
You swine!
I think what's the most amazing thing about the use of naturals is that is something which has not been recognized earlier within our industry. I think the reason for that is that the cosmetics and toiletry industries is being run by chemists and scientists. And these people are trained in the use of chemicals. These people are not trained in the use of naturals. And when we look at the naturals and investigate their properties, we're absolutely amazed. And if you think about it, it's common sense that an ingredient which has been used over thousands of years by different people in various parts of the world, it's gone through the process of safe selection. It's gone through the process of effectiveness. That's why it's not been used before. But there again, you know what they say about common sense. It's very uncommon.
This is what I call relaxing, sitting down for 5 minutes.
I don't like the cosmetic industry because it creates needs that don't exist. I don't like it because it's run by men who are very, very conservative and actually haven't any notion of what women want. They work on fears, the fear of aging. I think it's immoral to trade on those fears. I think it's immoral to lie. I think it's immoral to have a product which is basically oil and water to be as expensive as gold. We have a society that, because of advertising pressure in the beauty industry, says to be perfect, to be wanted and desired, you have to look like this. And this is usually Caucasian and usually 15 or 16 or 17. Flawless, airbrushed. And here are the products to look like this. And so you buy these products with a belief that you will end up looking like this incredible, perfect person. All of those steps are a lie. I mean, it's bizarre. It's all, for me, bizarre. That your value is not in what you do anymore, but it's supposed to be in what you look like or the age in which you are. And it doesn't work, you see. That's what I think is bizarre. Nothing will stop you looking older. Nothing. You can have a facelift, but then you look like some moron out of the sky, you know, out of a planet, you will look the same. You know, the greatest thing, if you want to have this impression of being younger, is to have the greatest sex life in the world.
Anita met her husband, Gordon, in the roaring 60s. While traveling, Gordon turned up at the club Anita's mother ran. Impressed by this young man, Anita's mother wrote her enthusiastic letters.
If you talk to another person about how wonderful this, let's say, my mother was telling Gordon how wonderful, crazy, wonderful I was, and she was telling me how wonderful Gordon was. So you're in love with somebody before you even meet them. I mean, at least you're sympathetic to them. So she kept on telling me, I arrived back, she was telling me how this wonderful, crazy Scots person, this poet, blah, blah. So I thought, well, I was sympathetic to meeting him even before I arrived. So I met him and I just knew instantly, that's it. You're going to be the father of my children.
Stepping out there and seeing what the reality of the world is like is terrifying. realizing that people make conscious decisions to do something that is wrong. You know, to do something that is not right and is going to have irreversible effects. It blew out my mind, and suddenly I had a mission, you know. Not a mission in a sense of a holy spiritual sense, but something that I ingrained in my soul I felt was totally wrong, and that I had to voice out about it. I had to tell people that they're, you know, what was happening. And that's what happened to me in Altamira.
Altamira is a strange town. It's right in the northwest of Brazil. It's like a really frontier town. People come in their horses, they've got guns in their holsters, there's bordellos, bars, you know. And it was this area where the World Bank were going to put in build 5 dams. And the rainforest people, who never had done this before in Brazil, got together to protest to the world, to the media, to the World Bank, to stop this. And it was so extraordinary watching these row upon line of dancing, chanting Caipo as they entered into the auditorium. So Sam and I felt it's not only good enough to be able to experience this, let's do something about it. So she came back and did a speech at our international franchise meeting and raising £250,000 from our staff and our franchisees to buy, really for the security of the Caipo. So we got this little plane from Canada so that they can check on the burning, communicate. And then we said, well, it's no good gifts like that, a friendship, you have to do something for them.
Since 1987, the Body Shop has operated its own fair trading schemes in developing countries. And these countries grow ingredients and make products for the Body Shop. This provides employment and trade, and the Body Shop calls this approach trade, not aid. The principles of trade, not aid are really simple. You don't change the ecology, you don't change the culture. You reward them, they're the primary producers. You pay good trading prices.
I gave a talk at a business conference in England, and I was talking about work like Trade Not Aid, which is basically a simple way of setting up micro-enterprises in the developing world, in the majority world, where you work with their resources, you ask them what they want, you work with them, you care about them. And he said, well, what are you doing in England? And we all the Body Shops do community projects in their own time, but we hadn't set up an economic initiative. So he said, come up to Scotland, come up to Glasgow. There's a small township outside Glasgow called Easterhouse. And there they have about 50,000 people. He said it was our own third world, that's what he said. And a lot are out of work, maybe 70% out of work between the ages of 17 and 21. And just see if you can come up with anything imaginative.
We needed soap. We didn't make soap at all in the Body Shop. They were all made by subcontractors for us. And the crucial thing that this area still needs is jobs. So we established the factory and it began operating in 1988. It would have been simpler to make the soap down in Littlehampton, but Body Shop's philosophy very much is if there's a need somewhere and it can be met by establishing some offshoot of the business, helping the community, then those are two things that match well together.
Almost 30 million bars of soap are produced every year here in the Easterhouse plant, providing 125 people with a job.
There's been a lot of unemployment at the moment. It's quite a lot. Actually, one was for my husband as well. He's unemployed, and I've seen a lot of people really going downhill because of unemployment, and there's people heading now for drugs because, I mean, they're just so fed up. I mean, they haven't got a chance to do anything.
I feel that being involved in that type of work makes the job something more than simply arrive and making soap. This is the philosophy that Body Shop workers, I think, throughout the world have, that it adds another dimension, and in many ways it adds facets of thinking and facets of contribution that really permeate all levels of society.
It's changed my life, right? It's really built me up at first, because before I got that job in here, I was unemployed for 12 years, and myself, I gave up hope.
Social activism is a core business for the Body Shop. The staff of every shop are involved in so-called community care projects.
You're just not a 9-to-5
come in, stand behind the till, ding in your numbers and go home. It's nothing like that. I mean, we do ladies' nights and ladies' talks and kids' talks where we stay in the shop till maybe 8 or 9 o'clock at night, and people come in when the store is closed and we talk to them about any subject they want us to talk about to do with the body shop or environmental issues. And that's commitment from all of us together, and we enjoy it. We go out, we do university talks as well to schools and universities. We've got quite a few lined up over the next few months.
See, the word love is very threatening in a business environment. Putting your love where your labour is basically what the work that you do, the employment that you have, should be treated with the same love and the same sense of joy as you treat, let's say, relationships. It means that you love the people you work with. You care about them. You care about their needs and their feelings. You care about them as individuals in a family. You listen to them. You put all your energies and passion into the workplace as equally as you can put your energies and passion into a hobby. And for me, it separates work. I don't understand what work is anymore because it's perfectly everything I care about is and love is in my workplace.
Before I left, I asked the colour twirler if I could come back again to visit him. He said I could, as long as I told no one about Fantasia. The next day, I was on my way to the waterfall when I spotted one of the factory men looking around. He asked me if I had seen any strange birds. I told him, I often came to the waterfall, but never saw anything unusual. He seemed to believe me and went away. As soon as he is out of sight, I went through the waterfall and back into Fantasia. There was no bird in sight. I was worried, but then I remembered their secret hiding place. I called out, "It's all right, you can come out now. The men have gone. They won't come back because they've already looked here. Don't be scared." To this day, the colour twirler still lives near the waterfall, and still no one knows where he and his friends live. Thank you very much.
The approach that the hippie movement took was that approach had to be kinder and gentler, that there are just different ways of measuring yourself and your worth. It's not how much you earn or how much you own or acquire around you. It's what you give, what you contribute, what you put back, what your thumbprint has been. I think the worst side of the 60s was that you didn't sustain anything. You just had all these ideas. You sat around smoking dope and thinking and emoting, but you didn't do anything. But what you were doing, I think, was creating a fascinating language of change. You were creating the possibility of a change.
We have the chance to turn the pages over.
The campaigning that we do is because it's in our heart and we want to do it. And thank God the customers have given us enough profit for us to do that. It doesn't bear any relationship to the products. When we campaign for an issue, whether it's a human rights issue or tribal rights or animal testing, with thousands and millions of people writing letters, they use the shop as an arena of education. We don't get thousands of million people buying shampoo.
Even the trucks are used for campaigns to inform the public on acid rain, the ozone layer, the genocide of indigenous tribes. This company spends no money on advertising. It prefers to invest in good ideas, like a wind farm, a gift of British national power.
She is willing to bring in all kinds of expertise. She's willing to bring in all kinds of anthropologists or ethnobotanists, people who've been in the field a lot and have relationships with traditional people, and she listens to them. So she's not just listening to the traditional people one-on-one, she's also listening to those people who bridge the gaps. And she's willing to take in an enormous amount of information, which always amazes me.
There's no doubt that a strong commitment to environmental excellence can cost money, but also it can save money. We often say to other industries who are a bit reluctant to take the environment seriously, look, there are ways you can save money. But obviously the Body Shop is not doing this to save money. We're doing it because we believe it's the only way to trade ethically and to behave as a business. So in a sense, whatever it cost, we would do it. It just so happens at the moment that is a successful formula for the Body Shop, and that by making environmental excellence and social commitments integral to our business, that does not detract from the economic success of the company.
You know, we see lots of T-shirts come in with, you know, Greenpeace or Amnesty International or all kinds of social issue T-shirts, and very receptive to our pamphlets and the things that we talk to them about. And we've got a community project going. We work in the AIDS Memorial Grove in Golden Gate Park, and people are interested in hearing about that.
It's an educational experiment, the Body Shop. And it is a business experiment too. And in our experiment, we're keeping the shareholders happy. I mean, our shares defy gravity, so that's happy. That's all dealt with. But in our experiment, we want to show the way that you can rewrite the book and how you deal with the third world. You can, or the majority world. You can rewrite the book and how you can empower your staff without being in fear of them. You can rewrite the book on global responsibility. You can rewrite the book in terms of, you know, how you can make the workplace the most fun, aesthetic looking place and still keep your, you know, shareholders and the banks happy. But if we ever, ever get to be like those large corporations, like the multinationals, ever be like them, then our experiment would have failed.
Consumers are the people who ultimately have to create a moral economy. If they're going to purchase something that they believe in and didn't manipulate or abuse someone along the way, they're the ones who are the ultimate arbiters. They're the ones who can stand up and say, no. And I think in the case of this company, it's something quite unique, and that's that, you know, it doesn't advertise, so it doesn't take part in that part of the economy. And it's setting out certain new ways of being in a business community, and consumers are buying it. This is
And I would like to see that there's a huge stigma on corporate crime and that people say no because, you know, we are your customers, we are your consumers, because we provide the profits, we're going to provide the ethics. I will not buy your products because they represent the worst thing you could possibly do.
Hey, can you grab one of those signs and hold it up for
it? Stop them burning! Stop them burning!
The company stands up for its ideals, driven on by an imaginative, outspoken founder, determined to change the world.
The writing is on the wall that corporations, institutions have to change. It's the end of a decade, you know. It's the end of a century. It's an end of a millennia. That's 10 centuries. And historically, people have always been, thought processes have always been reflective. You know, you look back and think, what has been the most wonderful things that the humanity has done and what have been the major mistakes? So I think this is a time for reflection. And I think this is a time now where we no longer accept the myth that science and technology and what we produce are within realms of science and technology that push us into more consumerism or push us into trying to understand the planet on with those terms is the right way. What I think is coming through is sense of intuition and a sense of where feelings. You know, you can have science of something, but science doesn't tell you about how you feel about something. What's your intuition? What's your real, your inspirational intuition? I think that's changing. I think the change is going to come too because young people, we've had are morally bereft. It's like a desert out there. Who are the heroes? Who are the people that they can look up to? You know, they've gone. Where are the Martin Luther Kings? Where are all the good, you know, the revolutionary thinking that is going on? I think the revolution is going to be that there's got to be a sense of cooperation now. It isn't the matter of one controlling the other, that the North controls the South or the East controls the West. It's got to be cooperation because we have a major enemy, and it's ourselves and our sense of destruction and how we're destroying the planet. But also our sense of isolation, our
sense of family has gone, sense of community has gone, the sense of being able to identify, have empathy with suffering, it's all going. We're all isolated by television or we're isolated by other things. So I believe it's changing. And I believe because I know. I always go towards people whose vision is bigger than myself. And I see around the planet, around this world, people whose thinking is absolutely identical to mine, that have got there through intuition, through having a historical perspective on their lives. And they're all saying the same things. Business has got to be conducted kinder, gentler. We've got to give more back. We can't, you know, be measured by how... We've got to be measured by how we treat the weak, not how much we acquire, not what is our right or territory. And I believe that's happening in all aspects. And I think companies, we will be, you know, companies will very much trade like us because young people are saying they only want to work for traditional companies, they only want to work for socially responsible companies. They don't want to work for people who don't value themselves, their heart, their spirit. That's what I'm seeing, you know, with the young.
So that's it, folks. All we are good traders. All we are basically have this global sense of responsibility. And we don't know how to run our business in any way. People call us activists and that it's a sham that we're in business and that all we want to do is to buck the system. They're absolutely bloody right. We do want to buck the system.